ಸೌರ್ನಂದನ ಪ್ರಜಾಧನ ಸಂಜನಾಯ ಯಸೌರನಂದನ ಪ್ರಜಾಧನ ಸಂಜನಾಯ ಜಮ್ಮುನ ಚೀರಾಹಾನಿ ಶಾಮಿ ಶಾಮನ ಚೀರಾಹಾನ ಶಾಮಿ ಶಾಮಿ ಜಯ ಮಾಧವ ಕುಂಜ ವಿಹಾರ ಕುಂಜ ವಿಹಾರ ಹರಿ ಹರಿ Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare Ram. Nithai Gaur. Nithai Gaur. Hare Ram. Ram Ram. Nithai Gaur. Hare Gaur. Hare Gaur. Hare Gaur. Nithai Gaur. Nithai Gaur. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki
start off with a little story. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prastaya Bhutale Srimakti Bhakti Vedanta Swami Tiname. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharini Nirvishesa Sunyavadi Pastyatya Desvatarine Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasati Gaur Bhaktarindam Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Disciples, they come and pick up their spiritual master and from the airport, and they hired a beautiful limousine. In fact, it was gold, nice, and they had a hired driver, everything. So the guru was really surprised. He said, "Oh, wow. Where? How'd you do this?" He said, "It's your mercy, Guru Maharaj." So they drove him to the temple, got there, and they had a special red carpet and so many nice things arranged and a beautiful room. He sat down, he said, "Oh, wow, this is really amazing." They said, "Yes, it's your mercy, Maharaj." So then they served him this big feast, nice prayer prepared with the finest foods. And then he said, "Wow, how did you ever do this?" He said, "It was your mercy." And then he said, "Can you give me my bank book?" And he looks at it, and he sees there's nothing in it. He said, "What happened to the money?" "Well, we said everything was your mercy." Not like that. Anyway, just kind of loosen up the day here. Anyway, so what is a... We spoke about... What is a spiritual master? What are the positions of the spiritual master, the different kinds, the importance and the necessity of taking a spiritual master? What else did we do? The guru is one. We mentioned guru is different. Guru is one and different simultaneously. Guru is actually acting none different than the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his function for his disciple. So we seem to have covered a lot of the stuff that I was going to cover in this lecture in the first one. But we'll go over it, and we'll just to make sure this particular lecture is qualifications of a bona fide spiritual master. So it gets a little bit more into the what we say, the personality. A spiritual master is Shakshad, honey. Shakshad is one who is empowered by the Lord. And an organization may designate a person to become a representative of God in the form of a spiritual master who officiates on behalf of the Lord. But it's not the organizational stamp that makes the person the spiritual master. It's the empowerment from God himself. Therefore, the organization must act on behalf of the Lord in order to give approval for a person to take up that responsibility. Still, that is required. But therefore, it says that a guru is not some, you know, representative of an ecclesiastic organization. He is Krishna's representative to do the work of the Lord within the world, and that is to reclaim the conditioned souls from their illusion. Qualifications of a spiritual master, and this is the one that really starts to root out those persons who are not spiritual masters who may claim it, must come in disciplic succession. In the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, verse number 2, Evam Paramparam Praptir Evam Rajasayo Vidu. And Krishna explains that, you know, this science of the eternal relationship between the soul and the Supreme Soul was lost in due course of time. So I have come again to reestablish the disciplic succession and to again bring that knowledge back into the proper perspective so everyone can understand it. So a spiritual master must be in line from Krishna. So in these days we have what is called the four bona fide sampradayas. There are the Brahma, Madhva, Gaudiya Sampradaya. We are from that Sampradaya. Lord Brahma is our Sampradaya Acharya. Gaudiya, Madhva Acharya is also part of that Sampradaya, although he has a separate Sampradaya. And there is also Gaudiya. Gaudiya means Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, like that. So Brahma, Madhva, Gaudiya, Sampradaya. And then there is the Sri Sampradaya, Ramanuja Sampradaya. Each of the Sampradayas have a particular, you know, guru. Brahma, Gaudiya, Madhva, Sampradaya. This course is Lord Brahma. Sri Sampradaya is Lakshmi Devi. And then there is the Vishnu Swami, or the Rudra Sampradaya, and that is Lord Shiva Sampradaya. And then there is the Four Kumaras, Sanat Tushana Sampradaya, that is the, what is that Sampradaya called? Nimbarka Sampradaya, yeah, where Nimbarkacharya is the main person, like that. So Srila Prabhupada has commented that outside of these Sampradayas, no one can practice bhakti yoga efficiently or properly. So one has to connect with one of the four Sampradayas. But in this age, it's specifically emphasize of Mahaprabhu's presence within the world makes the availability of Vrindavan Dham available to everyone in this age. So Lord Chaitanya is Krishna himself. He has appeared in that to bring the Sampradaya teachings to the highest level of understanding and drop the qualifications for practice of spiritual life. We'll speak about that previously. Well, I mean, later we'll speak about what is the qualifications of a bona fide disciple like that. So one has come in the line of disciplic succession. So one who is an acharya must, or a spiritual master, must have a spiritual master himself who has come in that same line. And all the way back to Krishna. Because all of these four sampradayas are empowered by the Lord themselves, like that. So, like that. The spiritual master is a direct manifestation of the Lord and non-different from the Lord. So this is, you know, quite hard to understand, because sometimes by observation of the spiritual master, one sees what we say ordinary material, you know, characteristics. He was married, he went to school, he grew up, he was like me. I actually knew him when he was a kid, you know, something like that. So, but Arche Vishnu Siladi Gurushu Normati Vaishnave Jati Bhuti. Gurushu Normati means the spiritual master is not coming from any particular background or caste or creed or like that. He's an empowerment from the Lord Himself. So there was that famous 1966. Srila Prabhupada gave his first initiation to the new disciples on 22nd Avenue. And then Prabhupada, at the end of the initiation, gave the initiation lecture. And the last thing he said was, and one should see the spiritual master as God. And then he left, walked, turned around and got off the, you know, diocese and disappeared. Being very new in Krishna consciousness, this really shook people to the core. And therefore, because what had Prabhupada was saying earlier was, anyone who says he's God, G-O-D, is D-O-G, dog. And he was stressing that. But now he is saying one should see the spiritual master as God. So that created some, you know, confusion and even a loss of faith. And practically everyone was there, except one or two people understood. And they explained that he's not saying he's God, but we should see him that way. So in other words, as you serve the spiritual, as you would serve Krishna himself, you would serve the spiritual master in the same way. Because the spiritual master is not the enjoyer of the gifts given by the disciples. He takes whatever the disciple gives and he offers it to Krishna. He is only the transparent by a medium between Krishna and the disciple. Srila Prabhupada said the best example of a spiritual master's position is like the eyeglasses. Now, if the eyes are impaired, the vision cannot see the object clearly, or may not even be able to see the object at all. So the spiritual master gives the vision where the disciple can approach and serve the Lord, like that. And therefore he is the transparent via media. If he's not transparent, then he's not a via media. He has to be transparent. Transparent means that he is simply an aid in the relationship between the disciple and the Lord. But that aid is necessary. Because, as we mentioned earlier, no one can approach the Lord in this age unless they are pure. And to become pure, one has to practice this process of bhakti. And in order to learn the science of bhakti, one has to get directions on one who is both engaged in the science and also can teach that science to others like that. So the spiritual master is what we say the medium between. So therefore, if God comes personally, he comes in the form of the spiritual master. So that's why it says one should offer everything to the spiritual master, including one's life. Anything less than that, that is a lack of surrender. So that's scary, right? But when you have trust in the spiritual master, then there's no question like that. Because the spiritual master is not the enjoyer of the gifts or whatever you give him, either the praise, the position, the facilities, the perks, as we use, you know, more of a common word now. He takes and what is offered to and gives it to the Lord. We have taken upon ourselves the responsibility of welcoming a grave charge. All the audience have accepted ordinary seats. I alone have been provided with a lofty seat. All are being told, in effect, do have a look at the big animal from the zoo gardens. What arrogance! So foolish, so wicked. Have you ever seen such a big brute? Garlands of flowers have been put around his neck. What laudations, what bombastic landrang and hyperbolic adjectives. And how complacently, too, he is listening to the praise of his own achievements. How intently and with his own ears. He also feels delighted in mine. Is he not acting in plain violation of the teachings of Mahaprabhu? Can such a brute, so selfish and insolent, be ever reclaimed from brutishness? Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati. I happen to be one of the greatest fools. No one offers me good advice on account of my arrogance. Inasmuch as nobody condescends to instruct me, I place my case before Mahaprabhu himself. A thought occurred to me that I would make over the charge to myself to him, and see what he would advise me to do. Then Sri Chaitanya Dev said to me, "Whomever soever you meet us, instruct him regarding Krishna. By my command, be Guru, deliver this land. In this thou wilt not be obstructed by the current of the world. Thou wilt have my company once again at this place." In these verses, it is to be found the proper explanation of the apparent inconsistency noticed above. He whose only teaching is humility greater than the blade of grass said, "By my command, be Guru, save this land." In this instance, Mahaprabhu himself has given the command. His command being, perform the duty of the Guru, even as I do it myself. Also convey this command to wherever you chance to meet. Chaitanya Dev says, tell them these words. By my command, be Guru, save the land. Deliver the people from their foolishness. Now, whosoever happens to hear these words would naturally protest with palms joined, but I am really a great sinner. How can I be a guru? You are God himself, the teacher of the world. You can be guru. To this Mahaprabhu replies, in this thou will not be obstructed by the current of the world. Thou will have my company once again at this place. Do not practice the craft of a guru for the purpose of injuring others through malice. Do not adopt the trait of a guru in order to get immersed in the slough of this world. But if you can indeed be my guileless servant, you will be endowed with great power, then you need not fear. So then, this is really long. This goes on. It's a whole. But at the end he says, you know, I'm willing to take the criticism that what people say because I have accepted this position, but because Mahaprabhu has commanded me to do so, I'm willing to take such respite on their behalf. So a guru is one who is simply, you know, acting on the instructions of the Lord himself. It's not a position of elevation for enjoyment. It's simply done as a service to the Lord. And one who takes that position must be, what we say, free from that mood. Otherwise, they can't properly guide and instruct their disciples like that if they're trying to take something from themselves. And Mahaprabhu also says in another place that one of the considerations that a spiritual master have, he should not take too many disciples, because that causes what is called a burden. And if one is not powerful enough, then that can also cause the spiritual master to have difficulties. Just like Prabhupada says, you know, if the devotees don't follow carefully, the spiritual master has bad dreams. It's not that the dreams are coming from him, but the dreams are coming from the errant disciples who are breaking the principles like that. So he cautioned us, you know, please follow your vows very strictly and be very sincere in the practice of your devotional service, and don't cause your spiritual master any extra problems. So the point is that there is a lot of responsibility and there's no glory in being a spiritual master. There's no glory. It looks like there's a lot of glory. And that is from the external point of view. But it is a great responsibility. And therefore, as it says, that one who's given a lot is expected. And one who's given little, little is also expected, like that. So I'm just going into a little bit of the aspects of the consciousness that makes up one who takes on the responsibility of a spiritual master like that. The spiritual master sees his disciples as a father would see his children. And so the father maintains the family in the best possible way, given what is necessary for the children to grow like that, and provides also, you know, extra care when required. So in the same way, the spiritual master is duty-bound to take his disciples back to Godhead. Prabhupada says, Prabhupada was asked the question, what happens if we don't make it back to Godhead? We hear that the spiritual master has to come back and reclaim his disciple in the next life. Prabhupada said, yes, therefore make it back to Godhead. Don't give me any trouble extra. So therefore the service, how does the spiritual master view his disciple? He views that the success of the disciple is not their abilities or their finances, or their good births, or whatever. It's their sincerity to carry out the instructions. That's what makes a disciple a disciple. One who sincerely follows the instructions of the spiritual master becomes dear to the spiritual master, and therefore gets the mercy like that. Now, these are some of the qualifications of a spiritual master. We spoke about Guru's one. Guru is different. We mentioned that one must take instructions and initiation, shelter from one who is an Uttama Adhikari. But the Uttama Adhikari may not be available, so one can take guidance from a person who is on the Madhyamam platform. And therefore, one can make advancement up to the level of the spiritual master. The spiritual master can also make more advancement. And in the same way, they both can reach the highest platform like that. When Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati asked, how many disciples do you have? He says, I have no disciples. I see all my, those who have come to me, they are all my spiritual masters. I learn from them. If a person thinks they're a guru, Did you catch the word difference? A person thinks he's a guru, he's a guru. Guru instead of guru. What is guru? Cow. Or an animal. That's basically what it's being said. So a guru who thinks he's a guru is not a guru. One is acting in that position, but one has to understand that he is also a disciple, playing the role of a guru. Therefore, one's internal identity should not overshadow one's service position. Guru is a service position. It's not his identity. So what is our identity? Jiva Sarupai Nitya Krishna Das. We're all eternal servants of Krishna. When Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati was asked again the same question, he said, how many disciples do you have? He said, I have four, two arms and two legs. They carry out my instructions. Now, you might read a few lines into that one. That one needs some explanation. I'm not going to explain it. But basically, he's also saying that, you know, I don't see myself as a guru, nor should anyone who's doing that service see themselves in that same way. And that's true about any position. If one identifies themselves with the position, they are an illusion because the position is changing, and but the identity of the individual never changes. So we accept position for service or responsibility, but our identity remains the same. Like that. So a spiritual master is an eternal servant of the Lord playing the role of a spiritual master. That's all. When Prabhupada one time was glorifying his own disciples, he says, I am seeing all of you as representatives of my spiritual master. Therefore, you are my spiritual master because my spiritual master has sent you to me to assist me in spreading Krishna consciousness all over the world. Therefore, you are representatives of my spiritual master. Now that's really humility. Amazing. And Prabhupada was seeing his disciples as representative of his spiritual master who have come because of his spiritual master's mercy. So that's how a spiritual master sees. He sees that I'm trying to do the work on behalf of my spiritual master. In order to help me, he sends you to me to assist me in my service to him. So that's how the spiritual master sees like that. He doesn't think that by his own endeavor, everything is happening like that. Okay. There is no such thing as your guru and my guru. There's only one guru, Krishna. And Guru Krishna manifests himself in different forms. Therefore, guru is one. This is important to understand because we see that in organizations that have many spiritual masters. And just like we had that one story, which is really not a story. It's more like an abomination, to use a very nice word, where on one fast day, which was the appearance day of Srila Prabhupada, one Prabhupada's disciple was walking in Mayapur, and he saw this young brahmachari eating pizza. And, you know, he felt some inclination to speak to him. He said, today is Prabhupada's, you know, appearance day. We're fasting today. He said, well, Prabhupada's your guru. He's not my guru. Hare well. The devotee was so shocked that he couldn't speak. Later on, he wrote an article about this. That, you know, we make this distinction like that. Of course, you know, for disciples on their individual guru like that. But when it comes to Srila Prabhupada, He doesn't fall into that category of my guru, your guru. He's the guru of everyone because he is the founder of charity of the ISKCON Society. And therefore, everyone worships him as the spiritual master. Everyone worships Prabhupada equally. Either direct disciples or those who are disciples of his disciples have a direct relationship with Prabhupada. So that's the position of the founder Acharya. So I was making that point. But back to the other point I was making, and that is your guru and my guru, we get into this, you know, little, you know, what they call it, cliquish kind of thing. And then we think, well, my guru is, you know, he dances better than your guru, he sings better than your guru, he speaks better than your guru, you know, he even looks better than you. But it says that if you see a deformity, even a physical deformity, in the spiritual master, and you think that's a disqualification, that's called offense. Because there's no material, what we say, qualification to become a spiritual master. Or there's no material disqualification for not becoming a spiritual master. In any case, it's always, you know, Krishna's empowerment, like that. Okay, so these are some of the qualifications of a spiritual master. And the point is, and this is what Prabhupada wants, he wants everyone in ISKCON to become gurus. Isn't that wonderful? Those who are disciples are meant to become gurus. And what does that mean? That you also become perfect in your execution of devotional service, and you also take on the responsibility of accepting disciples. And that way the disciple succession continues to expand more and more like that. Himanshu Prabhu, we have a roving mic. We should have one devotee who likes to run. Is there anybody here who likes to run? I'm sure there's a few runners. Okay. You want to run the microphone from person to person? Okay.
Maharaj, this came up recently in a discussion. Why is it that one of the qualifications of a Diksha Guru is that he has to be a man? Why can't women be Diksha Gurus?
Well, we have our history. Now, someone asked Prabhupada, can women become spiritual masters? That was the exact question. And Prabhupada said, we have our Janava Devi, who was the wife of Lord Nityananda. So Prabhupada acknowledged that women can also become spiritual teachers like that. Now, the question is, and this is going to open up a whole nother talk, so I'm a little bit hesitant here, because right now that issue is, you know, being discussed on whether we do it carte blanche or we have considerations of who within the category of women who are qualified can actually do that service like that. What does it mean? So there are ecclesiastical considerations, there's time, place, and circumstance, there's qualifications that need to be considered also. So that whole argument was put on hold last year, and it's coming up again this year. So stay tuned. Like that. But in principle, you can't say, you can't exempt a human formed from being a guru simply by bodily designations, in principle. That's the principle. But how the principle applies, we'll see how that's discussed like that. Okay? Yeah, okay.
I've always wondered what, when Krishna says in 434 Bhagavad Gita that one must accept a spiritual master who has seen the truth. Mm-hmm. I've always wondered if that refers to seeing Shyama Sundar in Vrindavan, or if it means seeing that God is the cause and creator of everything. What is it, to what extent are we supposed to have seen the truth?
I guess, but the understanding is one who knows the truth. I'm not sure that word actually means vision, because one who knows the truth is one who has seen the truth. It's the same understanding. Seeing Krishna in the bushes of Vrindavan, but Prabhupada said, there's Krishna. He's standing on the altar of in the temple. Can you see him? Or you just see, you know, a deity there. Is that a deity or is that Krishna? Now, if you see Krishna there, that's seeing Krishna. But how much of Krishna can you actually see? That takes purified vision. Krishna reveals himself more and more according to the level of our surrender and the level of our service, both surrender and service. Well, surrender, service really means to surrender. So, I'm not sure that word actually means vision. I don't think so. I think it means one who knows the truth. When you thus know the truth, you know that all living entities are in me, they are mine. That's the next verse, 435. One who actually knows the truth knows that all living entities are in me, they are mine. They are my parts and parcels. So in the next verse, it gives the qualification for seeing the truth, that seeing Krishna with everything and everything within Krishna. So Prabhupada says, it's not like you see the form of Krishna, but you see Krishna within the energy and the energy within Krishna himself. The energy cannot work without Krishna, and Krishna is non-different than his energy in one sense. So that's the absolute principle of oneness, that everything ultimately is Krishna and at the same time not Krishna. One who knows that knows that's the knowledge of Achintya Bheda Bheda Tattva. It's also Achintya, which means it's inconceivable. Does that make sense?
It does make sense, because that is the philosophy, is that one should be able to see Krishna in everything. I guess I'm just confused, because ultimately we are supposed to see Krishna. Yes.
Well, Prabhupada, there he is. That's seeing Krishna. This is, I'm not just saying that in a very, you know, cheap way. Krishna's there. Can you see him? He's there. He's standing there. It's not like that's a deity. It's a deity, but it's Krishna in that's Krishna. Premanjaritam bhakti vilochanena santasa daiva ridayesha vilokayanti yam shama sundar chintya guna sarupam govindam adi purusham tamaham. When you have pure love for God, then you can see God everywhere and within everything. When Prabhupada is asked, can you see Krishna? Prabhupada said, there was never a time I was not seeing Krishna. So he has a vision of a Mahabhagava. Mahabhagava means they're actually seeing the form of Krishna everywhere. And they can talk to Krishna, and Krishna can talk to them. But seeing Krishna also means that seeing Krishna within everything, within the energy of Krishna as it's being directed by Krishna. Because Krishna says, not a blade of grass moves without my sanction. Nothing can happen without the sanction of the Lord. Can we see that? And then this needs further explanation also, too. But so I think the next verse answers your question. When you see everything in me and me and everything. You see all living beings within Krishna. Okay. Sri Devi, you had a question? Comment and question?
Yeah, I was just going to add a little something to what Prabhu said, if I may. Srila Prabhupada also said, don't try to see Krishna. Serve Krishna so he tries to see you. Is that correct?
That's Bhakti Siddhanta, yeah. Prabhupada would repeat that. Yeah, the thing is, we're not qualified to see Krishna, but we can become qualified through the service. When we serve Krishna and Krishna's pleased by our service, then Krishna reveals himself to the devotee through his service. And that revelation is in different forms. But when you're absorbed in service, then, you know, Krishna is there. He's none different than the service. So, yeah, the point is correct. Don't try to see Krishna. Try to serve in such a way. Krishna wants to see you.
And Maharaj, one more quote of Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada said, the guru is self-effulgent. You don't make a guru by legislation or appointment or some such thing. So that when a person is pure, it's self-evident that this person is pure, like the sun. And so there is...
Yeah, but the no. Owls can't see the sun. Although he's self-effulgent, there are still a lot of owls around. So there's some qualification needed. Right? It's true. The guru is self-effulgent. We can use the example when Krishna was here. He was personally present. How many persons actually understood him to be the Supreme? Prabhupada said only between 100 and 200. And he came in contact with millions of people. So because they didn't have the adhikari. Adhikari means qualification. Just like, give you the example, you look at the deity. You see one thing, somebody else may see something else. Somebody will see stone. Somebody will see Krishna. Somebody will see a representative of Krishna. So again, although self-effulgence is there, there has to be some preliminary qualifications. Just like Prabhupada said, if somebody shows you gold and says this is gold, if you don't know anything about gold, you may be cheated. So there has to be some preliminary qualifications in order to see like that.
So the qualification has to be on the part of the disciple.
Yeah. He must be free from envy. Then he can see, yeah.
Thank you.
Hi. Do you necessarily have to see him or can you feel?
It's better to hear. That's the actual way to experience is through hearing. Prabhupada used to say, don't try to see the spiritual master, but try to hear him. Hearing is the direct connection to the soul and also awakens with knowledge. Seeing may be or not, may be there, may not be there. It's not so important to see. But feeling is another expression of hearing. Yeah.
Maharaj, can spiritual master, if he is not present with his disciple, he is far from the disciple, can he understand the spiritual condition of the disciple by meditating on the disciple?
I don't think that's an absolute. I think it's true in many cases because Krishna within the heart, when he's in contact with Krishna in the heart, Krishna in the heart tells him the situation. It's not through meditation, it's through Krishna's revelation within the heart, Krishna's instruction about the situation of that disciple. He may not hear everything, but he knows that there's something is there, something needs to be done, or something that person is doing good, either one like that. So that's super soul. Super soul is in everyone's heart, and it's the same super soul. So super soul is giving the connection between the disciple and the guru, because the super soul is the internal manifestation of guru anyway. That's what super soul is. Super soul is guru. But Krishna within the heart as guru, that same super soul manifests himself outside as the spiritual master. That's called Chaita Guru. Chaita Guru is the guru in the heart, and guru outside is the spiritual master. Yeah. So yeah, Krishna will do that. He'll notify the spiritual master. If the spiritual master thinks, how's this disciple doing? He can fade. So many times he can understand. But for clarification, sometimes we just use emails. Sounds kind of like it makes things a little easier. Takes the mysticism out of it. Any other questions? Yes. Himanshu. Let's take Derek. He's got a question first. We'll get to the online questions also. And then online question is next. Okay.
Maharaj, should we view the spiritual master as completely perfected and infallible in all circumstances, or is there room?
If you don't see him that way, then you're going to have a problem. And if you find fault, then that destroys your faith. And if your faith gets destroyed, your surrender will be impaired, and then your surrender is impaired, and you're lost. Yeah. The spiritual master may be wrong, but he's right. Now, if he deviates, that's another thing. In other words, if the spiritual master says, well, we'll just follow three regulative principles, then you know he's off. Yeah, and then you know he's off, because that's not what the founder Acharya has said. He's not representing the founder Acharya anymore, therefore. But just like Prabhupada gave the example, Jai Sri Sri Kishore Kishori Ki Jai. Prabhupada gave the example when his spiritual master, he was there. They had this building, and the spiritual master and the devotees were up on the second floor of this marble building, and a snake had crawled up there. So everybody was running around, snake, snake, snake. So Bhaktisiddhanta came out and said, kill the snake. And so Prabhupada had a problem with that. He said, I couldn't think, how is my spiritual master ordering a living entity to be killed? And so, but he didn't doubt Spirit Bhaktisiddhanta's being right. He just couldn't understand it. And then later on, he read in the seventh canto of Srimad Bhagavatam that saintly persons take great happiness in snakes and scorpions being killed. It's not that they kill them themselves. A spiritual person doesn't kill anything. But in such cases, if these living entities are killed, it's not like, you know, it's a sin. It's not a sin under certain circumstances. So that was circumstances, was to protect the devotees like that. But generally, and Prabhupada, you know, didn't lose faith in his spiritual master, but he didn't understand it. That's why if you see something done by your spiritual master and you can't understand it or it creates a doubt, you better clear it up. Because a little doubt can lead to a larger doubt. So you have to get a clarification like that. And how you clear it up is important, not just clearing it up. You can't, you know, you do it in a respectable way. I'm seeing this. Can you please explain it to me? I don't understand like that. Prabhupada drank, you know, 7-Up. And everybody thought, oh, 7-Up is great. We'll all drink it now because Prabhupada did it. But then Prabhupada told him, you know, you shouldn't drink it. He just did it once because somebody had it. And he said, you know, he said they asked Prabhupada to try it. So he tried it just to see what it tastes like. It was like limca, you know. Like that. So, you know, it's not like Prabhupada drinks 7-Up. Okay, so. Any, okay, so we can continue. Oh, question online?
Yeah.
Can you tell us how many people are watching online?
Okay, can you tell us? 50?
18.
18? Okay. In Bhagavad Gita, this is Advaita Charan from Champaign.
Mm-hmm.
In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, he has two questions. The first one is, in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that the chain of knowledge was lost and he is reestablishing it. But in the introduction to Bhagavad Gita, the chain does not show that. How do we reconcile that?
He's saying the chain in the introduction doesn't show that, but how does he know that? What is the time period between those? Because it doesn't give the chronological time between that. It starts all the way with Krishna and goes to Brahma, Narada, you know, Vyas. So it was broken. That's what Krishna's saying, it was broken. So if you read the introduction, you can, you know, you have to understand it that it's not necessarily, you know, like one master is from coming from another master. That's the disciplic succession. That's all. The chain is broken. Krishna reestablished it. And Arjuna became the disciple. He also started. Arjuna became a disciple, and he also, there's a line coming from Arjuna, but where's that line now? That line we don't know. There's a lot of lines that somehow come off from the original line and spread out into different, you know, directions like that. So what's in the introduction are the prominent spiritual masters. Not necessarily one is coming from another like that.
Second question has to do with this: the point of relationship with Prabhupada. He says, we all have an equal relation. You mentioned that we all have an equal relationship with Prabhupada, but that seems slightly impersonal. I understand my relationship with my Diksha Guru to be very different from the one I have with Srila Prabhupada, though they're both very significant. And he also quotes, Prabhupada said to one of his disciples one time, that you can pray to Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati since the grandfather is more merciful than the father.
So what is the question?
The question is, when you say that I have a direct relationship with Prabhupada...
As the founder Acharya.
But that seems slightly impersonal. I understand my relationship with my Diksha Guru to be very different from the one I have with Srila Prabhupada. Though maybe, they're both very significant.
Yeah, they're both different, slightly different, but there's both direct relationship. Prabhupada, the founder Acharya, has a direct relationship with everyone because he's the founder Acharya. That's a unique position. It's not like, you know, guru and disciple. It's because we've come into the, you know, the precincts of ISKCON, everyone is connected to Srila Prabhupada through following his teachings, through executing his instructions, like that. We mentioned earlier that everything about this movement is Prabhupada. There's nothing outside of Prabhupada. Everything we do it in relationship to Prabhupada's instructions, whether directly or indirectly. So yeah, you have a direct relationship with your spiritual master, but you can also access a direct relationship with Prabhupada. You may not experience it, but you can access that if and you go deeper in your relationship with Prabhupada, and that's available. And as far as the grandfather spiritual master is, that's true. It's just like Prabhupada uses that little innuendo to help us understand that, you know, the grandfather spiritual master, we call him Param Guru, is really, really, what we say, more affectionate and kind to the disciples of his spiritual master. Because the guru has to be a little stricter, whereas the Param Guru doesn't have that position, so he's more like a grandfather. Your relationship with your spiritual master is usually one of, we'll talk about disciple, but generally, if a spiritual master praises his disciples, that destroys the disciples. And that's Chanika Pandit. It says that the spiritual master should always chastise his disciples. And the word is always. Now, Sue, you like that one? Yeah. No, you don't like that one at all. I'm sure Vidya doesn't like it even more than you. But for female disciples, we're a little more kinder. Because they have more problems. Generally. Not all the time. It's just it's not they have more problems, it's just the way life is, you know. So, yeah, there's that story where Bhagaji was serving Prabhupada in Vrindavan, and Bhagaji wanted to make Prabhupada some wheat germ halava. It was cold. So halava is not wheat germ. He happened to get some wheat germ from I don't know where. So he made this halava, and he was thinking, oh, Prabhupada's going to like this wheat germ halava. It's really healthy. So he made this big pot of wheat germ halava, Prabhupada's breakfast. Prabhupada looked at it and said, what is this? Prabhupada said, oh, this is very nice, Prabhupada. It's wheat germ halava. Prabhupada said, take it out. Immediately dismissed it. Bhagaji was brokenhearted. So he went into the temple room, and he started to pray in front of Bhakti Siddhanta. And he was really praying. Practically emotionally upset. And then at one point he heard Prabhupada call, Bhagaji, bring the halava. And then he ate the whole pot. Because Bhakti Siddhanta's mercy was like that. So that's the story of that. So yeah, usually the Param Guru doesn't chastise his disciples' spiritual teachers. That's why there's a little bit more mercy there, or a different kind of mercy. Okay? So you're lucky. All of you have Prabhupada as a nice grandfather. He loves you all. But his disciples will give you a hard time, though. Because you need it. All right, so I hope that sounds okay. If you expect praise from your spiritual master, you're in the wrong consciousness. But this is Kali Yuga. Everyone wants to be praised. But the tradition is, when you get chastised by your spiritual master, you're actually more happy than if you get praised. Because chastising corrects. And corrects means you grow. If you get praised, you don't grow. You just go down. You can go down from praise. You can't go down from chastisement. That's why a real disciple will look for, not do something to get chastised. That's not the idea. Because that's worse. But if it comes, then they think, oh, okay, I'm getting some mercy. Because you grow. Yes.
Carlos, although one has surrendered to Krishna, therefore to our guru too, there are disagreements and dissents. How to work out those or work those out without offending and looking for a common ground?
Between disciple and spiritual master?
I'm not sure, Maharaj. This is, I just read the question verbatim.
Read it again.
Although one has surrendered to Krishna, therefore to our guru too, there are disagreements and dissents.
Yeah.
How to work those out without offending and looking for common ground?
You inquire humbly. You put your doubt or your difference of opinion before your spiritual master in order to get clarification and understanding. You can do that, but you have to do it with humble and accept whatever is given.
Vyasa, Sukadev Goswami, and Narada were present in Mahabharata time period. So how do we understand that disciplic succession was broken, that Krishna re-established it, or is Krishna referring to King Parampara?
It's a matter of chronology. We're not really seeing the time periods, that's all. Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita. Mahabharata goes back way before Krishna. Way before Krishna. Mahabharata is like, Krishna is only 5,000, 113 years, I think. That was the beginning of Kali Yuga. When Krishna spoke to Bhagavad Gita at the end of Dwarpa Yuga. So that's not much time. I mean, Mahabharata goes way back before that. The Bhagavad Gita was placed in the Mahabharata at one point. But Mahabharata was already there. Mahabharata simply means the history of greater of this Bhartvarsha, which is this planet. So the records go way back, even hundreds and thousands of years. There's stories about things that happened in Satya Yuga, different yugas like that, millions of years. So if you're looking for chronology to understand things, you have to understand, it's not clear what are the time periods exactly. I mean, Rama appeared more than 2 million years ago. And we have that story available through Valmiki Muni's writings. Ram was in the 28th millennium of the, Chakshush Manu, or Vaivashvata Manu, maybe it was Vaivashvata Manu, which is more than two million years ago. So that record is there. But how much do we know between when Ram appeared and when Krishna appeared in between? So that's the difference of how much? 1,950,000 years. Yes.
Yeah,
the brother.
Yeah, he's asking, if one should view one's spiritual master as infallible, how should one view another spiritual master if one doesn't have faith?
If that spiritual master is a God brother, it says that one should worship and accept one's God brothers of one's spiritual master as if it was the same as one's spiritual master. In other words, we respect and honor that person in the same way. You might not take direct instructions, but the respect and honor has to be there. In other words, don't find fault. Like that. Fault finding is very much a part of Kali Yuga because there's so many faults. just the way this age is. So if you find fault in Krishna's representative or somebody senior, you know you're going to have problems immediately. Krishna doesn't tolerate that. You know, if you have doubts, ask questions. If you have problems with association with certain persons, stay a distance. Keep your distance and respect from afar. We can do that. We can't associate with everybody, but we can respect everyone like that without direct association. Avoid fault-finding, avoid criticism, and especially avoid blasphemy. Blasphemy means trying to find somebody's fault and broadcasting it around. So that's dangerous to one's spiritual life. Okay, so should we continue? Okay, qualifications of a guru. Did we cover it enough? I'll just read some things. One who acts according to scripture and also preaches, that's a spiritual master. He knows the scriptures, can defeat all opposing arguments in relationship, like that. Comes in disciplic succession. He's not a guru by business. He doesn't make guruship his business like that. He doesn't, he's not trying to gather followers, but if someone comes, he accepts it as Krishna's arrangement. Follows the specific succession. He's a representative of Vat, knows the scriptures, empowered by. He doesn't have to be a scholar. Gaur Kishore does. Babaji Maharaj could not write his name, but still he was the spiritual master of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta, who was one of the greatest scholars ever. So one who knows Krishna doesn't necessarily mean they have to have literary education like that. We have the example of Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj. When he speaks, it can be confirmed by Sadhu Shastra. Knows knowledge of Brahman. It doesn't have to be born in a particular family, a particular society like that. Must know the conclusions of the scriptures. Teaches. The strength of a spiritual master is, how many persons he can actually make Krishna conscious like that. And that doesn't mean just his disciples, others who he comes in contact with also, like that. Anything else? Guru, not before I, yes.
Mm-hmm. Raj, it is often said that the spiritual master can infuse bhakti into his disciple just by seeing at him. Is it right? Is it a correct statement?
Huh? If they just see him?
Yeah.
Well, if they see Krishna in him, yeah. The spiritual master is empowered. So that empowerment will be felt in the presence, in his presence like that. But don't wait for that. It's really easy. It's not a real big mystical thing. If you want to be, you want to know who a spiritual master is, just hear, that's all. Hear and try to understand, that's all. And ask questions for clarification. You know things through hearing like that. Okay, so why don't we go into the next lesson a little bit. What is the qualifications of an aspiring disciple? Is that all right? Or should we continue with Guru for more? I'm open to whatever is suggested. Disciple? What is a disciple? Okay, question. What does the word disciple come from? Which word? Huh? Say it nice and loud. Discipline. Right. With no, without discipline, there's no question of disciple. I know nobody likes that in this age. I got to do what you say, man. Not me. What about me? I got my independence. That's your problem. You got independence. Qualification for the aspiring disciple. Let's see what we can find here. Must work under the supervision of a teacher for at least 6 months to 1 year. Prabhupada, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructed Sanatana Goswami to write Hari Bhakti Vilas. In that he said, describe what is the qualifications of a guru, what are the qualifications of a disciple. So one of the principle is, there is called mutual behavior. Prabhupada used the word behavior. Mutual observation. The disciple sees whether the spiritual master is the person I want to take, and the spiritual master sees if this person is qualified to become a disciple. So there is that, it's called the testing period, where the aspiring disciple follows the instructions of the spiritual master to understand if this is my spiritual master or not. He may change. He must follow as if, you know, he is a disciple, but the only difference is he's deciding or she's deciding whether this is my spiritual master. Now, sometimes devotees mistakenly think if I aspire for something, someone, then I must take that person. No. You can aspire and you can withdraw at any time, and there shouldn't be any problems from either side like that. I know some spiritual masters who don't accept certain disciples because the disciple's nature is much different than the spiritual master's nature, and therefore that disciple will not grow under the guidance of that spiritual master. So that spiritual master, in order to benefit that prospective disciple, points that disciple in another direction and says, maybe you should look in different places like that. A spiritual master is not trying to make disciples. That's not the program. How many I have, it's like that. So at the same time, there's that mutual, what we say, evaluation like that. What is the main qualification of a disciple? Sincerity. I want to learn about Krishna. I want to become a devotee of Krishna. I want to make my life, you know, successful, perfect, like that. That has to be there. Now, when one is aspiring, you should expect that they'll be tested. So aspiring disciples are usually tested by the spiritual master like that. Okay. Well, we got a lot of things here. Qualification of a disciple. Well, we'll get into the disqualifications of a disciple later. So, I'm a little overwhelmed with material here. Oh. Here is the main qualification that is the characteristic of a sincere disciple. And it was brought out by Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati in relationship to our spiritual master, Srila Prabhupada. When one of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati's disciples came to him and said, I want to recommend Abhay Prabhupada for written initiation, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati said, "Oh, yes, I have marked him. He likes to hear." So this is the main qualification. Disciple likes to hear. He's eager to hear. He's enthusiastic to hear. So this is one of the main things. When a spiritual master sees, disciple likes to hear, is eager to hear. And how do you know if a person is actually hearing? What are the qualifications for proper hearing? Just like we're all listening now, what makes hearing successful? Padma Purana explains, and this is important, because hearing is the basis of connection. One, faith in the speaker. Two, submissiveness to the message. Three, pushing out the other thoughts within the mind as they come in. As you're hearing, I'm sure, you know, you're also thinking, getting close to lunch. Something like that. Or I forgot to leave the car keys so my wife could find them, or something like that. You know, our mind's tendency is to go to different thoughts while we're listening. And the third qualification or principle is destroying the faults in the mind, pushing out all other thoughts and focusing on the sound like that. And the fourth is the culmination, is two things you get from attentive listening, attentive hearing. One, you get realization of what's being said. Two, you get questions appear in the mind like that. So if we're not getting either realization or questions, that means we have to work on our hearing like that. Like that. So, any questions about hearing? How important it is? Yes.
Hare Krishna. What are some practical ways of improving our hearing?
Continue practice. Practice hearing. Practice. If you mentioned that when you're listening, either to a lecture or even to when you're reading, reading is another form of hearing, you push out all other thoughts. You don't allow them to occupy your mental space. You focus completely on the sound or on the words. That is absorption in the sound, and that brings about realization and questions like that. So hearing is an art, how to hear properly. But all arts are developed through the principle of practice. So eagerness will bring about faster, what we say, quality of hearing. You have to be eager to hear. Now what inspires eagerness for hearing is that the subject matter is important. If I don't think the subject matter is important, I may not be so eager to hear. So, there again is another point. Is that why is the subject matter important? Because it's the difference between happiness and distress. Transcendental knowledge is freedom, whereas ignorance is the cause of suffering and bondage. So by hearing, we get knowledge, and by getting knowledge, we get inspiration. By inspiration, we start to act, and by acting, we get realization. So this knowledge is valuable because it saves you from suffering. So an eagerness to hear is the quality of, you know, getting out of the suffering of the material energy. Look at Maharaj Parikshit. How eager was he to hear? He was, you know, cursed to die in 7 days. So imagine if you were in his position, how eager you would be to hear. But the Acharyas also say, Maharaj Parikshit had 7 days. You don't even know if you have 7 minutes. Does anybody know, or can anybody guarantee you'll be here tomorrow? You can't guarantee that. If you are, I won't believe you. You may be here, but there's no guarantee. Because the nature of this world is at any time, you know, you could disappear. It's just the way this world is. It's full of dangers at every moment. And, you know, there might be a bug in your body just building up, and all of a sudden you got cancer. You don't even know what's happening. This is the way this world is. So death is a feature of this world. So the eagerness to hear is important because we don't really know how much time we have. So make the best use of every moment. We assume I'll be around, but that assumption is another form of folly. That's right. Yes.
A question and a comment. Comment from Carlos. He says that the word disciple comes from the Latin word discipulus, which actually means is that one is pushed to learn.
Okay.
My question personally, Maharaj, is...
Thank you.
I've always wanted to understand the proper qualification for hearing Leela, because we understand that one has to be very, very advanced, but at the same time, we understand that hearing pastimes will help us become advanced. Mm-hmm. And it's not clear for me what is the qualification. I mean, obviously, one should be free of to some degree, envy, lust, things like that.
Well, yeah, but at the same time, by hearing Leela, you also get free. So the question is, you know, what Leela? So whatever Prabhupada has written, fine. But don't go to other sources and look for the special stuff, you know, or the intricate, you know, esoteric stuff. And then you're outside of your adhikari, you know. So Prabhupada wrote Krishna book. There's Krishna's pastimes, Lord Chaitanya's pastimes. We can read those books like that. That's fine. We should read them. But don't go looking around for people who are speaking all these leelas, you know, expecting to get some benefit from that. Hear from a pure devotee. Okay. Sri Devi, Jai Sisi Kishore Kishore Ki Jai. One of the qualifications of a disciple doesn't make absurd inquiries either. It says that absurd inquiries and blind surrender is rejected. Blind surrender. What's blind surrender? Means that without any knowledge, you just follow. Now, you should understand why you're following. That's not blind. If you know why, then you're not blind. Absurd inquiries. What is an absurd inquiry is Guru Maharaj, you know, I'm going to work these days and my wife doesn't make good lunch, you know. Can you talk to her for me? You know, I'm working hard and she doesn't appreciate me. She just gives me the same old sandwich every day. absurd inquiries. Something like that, anyway. I just made that up.
I'm not sure I should ask because it might be
absurd. Yeah, I know. That's why I said it just before your question. But go ahead anyway.
Sorry, Maharaj.
Make sure it has value for both you and for the audience.
Maharaj, at the time of death, supposing one hasn't achieved perfection.
Suchiam simitam gehe yoga brashta prajayate. You come back again in a good birth to pick up where you left off.
But can the spiritual master give you some extra special mercy and push you on?
He can do whatever he can do. Yeah, he can do that. But you have to warrant the mercy. But there's causeless mercy. But causeless mercy means the mercy that has a cause and you can't see it. Causeless mercy is not causeless. It's just like you can't see the cause. That's all. That's why it's called causeless. You've done something or you have something in the past that causes you to get mercy that is without a cause. But if you want to know the answer to your question, if you're sincere, you'll always be successful in Krishna consciousness. And sincere means you try to follow in the best possible way. That's all. What is our qualification? When Tamal Krishna Goswami asked Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada, you know, we can see we have no qualifications to become your disciple. How is it we had this good fortune? Prabhupada said, I created your qualifications. I mean, to actually practice bhakti yoga, you have to have some qualifications, but Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is so merciful that he's just dismissed all the qualifications in this age. And said, just chant Hare Krishna and take prasadam, that's all. So if you're sincere, you'll always get the mercy you need. It'll always be there. And we'll talk about insincerity later on. And so, sincerity means you try your best.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Another question somewhere?
Yes, Maharaj, we have an online question. It's by Shankar. The question is...
Shankar Pandit?
Shankar Jairam.
Shankar Jairam. Hare Krishna.
Many of Srila Prabhupada's direct disciples have become initiating spiritual masters. Are these spiritual masters pure devotees like Prabhupada?
Well, we mentioned that, that a guru can be on the Madhyaman platform. Madhyaman means that they have four qualifications. One, they give their love to Krishna. Two, they make friends with other devotees. Three, they preach to the innocent and try to raise them up. And four, they avoid the atheistic non-devotees. That's the Madhyaman platform. So Nectar of Instruction describes that gurus can be on the Madhyavan platform. Prabhupada was on the Uttamam platform. So who's on the Uttamam, who's on the Madhyam? You have to know the qualification and characteristics of both. And it's still very hard to understand that. But not everyone... Prabhupada used to say that if you simply remain sincere and follow my instructions carefully, you can be a spiritual master. You may not be on the Uttamam platform. There's even gurus on the, what we say, neophyte platform, but they can't really do much at all. But our movement functions on the Madhyaman platform in order to practice Krishna consciousness successfully. So a guru can be on that platform, yeah. So you, you know, I won't, you know, take the liberty to say, well, you know, not everybody's on the Uttamam or everybody's on the Madhyamam. I can't say that because, you know, that would be pretentious. But there are, you could have gurus on both platforms, yeah. Ask Shankar if he likes that answer. Is there any way? Shankar, if you have any response to that, please give us another question. Okay. Shivangi.
It's a comment on this question. Can I ask?
Of course. Yeah.
Maharaj, we both were listening to a class by Badrinarayan Prabhu recently, and he was talking about the same issue that is my spiritual master at an Uttama platform. So everyone thinks that their spiritual master is at the topmost platform and he's a liberated soul. So Badrinarayan Prabhu was giving a class on that, and he made a very nice point. He said that in India, you must have seen that a truck is moving at a particular speed, and a bicyclist, a person on a cycle, like, you know, cycle-like. So he may not be moving at the same speed, but if he holds on to the truck, so he starts moving at the same speed as the truck is moving. Mm-hmm. So he was saying that as long as a person follows Srila Prabhupada perfectly, he is on the liberated platform. It doesn't matter. And whether your guru is hearing Krishna's flutes, that's how he mentioned that. Your guru may not be hearing Krishna's flutes personally, but he is at the liberated platform as long as he's connected to Srila Prabhupada sincerely, the way you mentioned. And he also gave second example of a wire. Like if a wire, an electrical wire,
if it is connected
to the source, the current will flow. So as long as we are connected to the parampara, even though they are not at the Uttama level, they can still be considered as a liberated soul because they are following Prabhupada exactly.
Right.
So we really like that example.
Nicely explained. Thank you. Thank you. That was clear. Yes.
Carlos Prabhu has a question. One gets shelter under one guru's mercy, but with time finds another guru one can relate better to. Is this new guru is more convincing than our own guru? How can one conciliate this disjunctive situation?
Well, you can take that person as your shikshu guru. If you're not initiated and you're aspiring for a particular spiritual master, and you find someone else, then you can aspire for that person and give up the aspiration for your initial guru. But if you're already initiated by the one person, then if you're inspired by someone else, you can take that person as your shikshu guru. So there's no loss like that. Okay.
Thank you, Maharaj. Also, were the initiating gurus within ISKCON appointed by Prabhupada? Who is the authority to appoint gurus in ISKCON?
Prabhupada has set up a system for that in the GBC and gives the authorization, but there's a whole system which is really quite detailed. But how a person starts in that capacity is they preach. They preach and preach, and people come to their feet for surrender and for guidance. And then when that is recognized, then we can, then that person will be considered for evaluation as a spiritual master. So it's not like they just all of a sudden become guru. They actually do the work of a spiritual master first. And then when, you know, there are many followers, then there is that consideration that they can get official, what we say, sanction to act in that capacity. And that's the standard within the ISKCON. Mm-hmm. So that's under the guidance of an aspect of the GBC like that. So there's, you know, committees like that. And then there's, before a person has to be a spiritual master, there's a whole Yeah, and it's a real long process as far as how it's done, you know. But it starts with them preaching like that and getting persons inspired through their preaching. Okay.
Shankar Prabhu is another follow-up. The question is raised to understand how one becomes a guru and to increase faith in finding a guru since Prabhupada is not physically present. But I think you kind of already answered it by talking about the preaching point.
You follow the process, and it says Krishna actually in the heart inspires a person to appear in the life of that person when that person is ready. It says when the candidate is ready, the guru appears. Then you have to recognize. That's all. But Krishna will send you a spiritual master when you're ready. If you're not ready, you won't be able to recognize it. Krishna in the heart's doing that. So how do you become ready? You follow the process. You chant, you associate with devotees, you know, take prasadam, you read the books, do service when you can like that. You do all the activities. And then when you become serious and it becomes, you know, you've filled up in these activities, then you think, oh, maybe I should get initiated. Maybe I should take this as my life's activity. And then when you start thinking like that, and then in due course of time, Krishna will send someone like that. Krishna sends the guru. He sends. You give it to everybody. Huh? Yeah, you give it to everybody. Yeah. Okay, so where were we here? Over here, Terrence, that's right.
Okay. Hi, Krishna. I think you just answered my question, Maharaj. Something along the lines of what you just said was similar to my question. So.
Oh, it's okay, though?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. You like to hear. That means you're hearing nicely. Good. Sri Devi, you have another question? Okay.
Maharaj, we hear, or rather I've read about Lord Narsingdev giving great mercy to some devotees' parents, even though they never did any devotional service.
Lord can do whatever he wants. No one can tell the Lord what to do or what not to do. He is independent. If he wants to show special mercy to anyone, he can do it. And if he wants to neglect somebody, he can do it. That's his prerogative. It's not a very, well, you do this, you do that, you know. The Lord is the Lord. It's just like if there was that show on television, probably way before all of your time, called The Millionaire. You know the story, the show The Millionaire? Who goes back to the 1960s here? Anybody? I guess maybe you're not. You're more of the modern generation. But this show, The Millionaire, what was the show? It was this one person, you never saw his face. Now, Ronald Reagan, our former president, was the main character in this TV show. And Ronald Reagan was the assistant of this one man. And this man, you would only hear his voice and you would never see his face. And then he would call Ronald Reagan into his office and he would give him a check for $1 million and say, take this check and give it to this person here. So the whole story was, then Ronald Reagan would go knocking on this person's door and he would open up and said, here's a gift from this person. He's giving you $1 million. And then they would just like do somersaults in the air and so happy. So the whole story was this person a lot of times didn't have any relationship with the people he was giving the money to, but he just knew about these other people and wanted to benedict them for some reason or another. So that's Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He does that. If he wants to give someone mercy, you can't stop it. And if he wants to neglect somebody, they can't do anything about it. The Lord's totally independent. So you'll find many stories of apparent reasons that have no reasons why the Lord shows mercy to certain people like that. So that's the Lord.
Thank you, Maharaj.
He can do that. Okay. Qualification. Okay, another qualification is eager to get out of material life. Haribo. Well, I want Krishna and I want Maya. Right? No way, Jose. You can't have both. Krishna doesn't share any program with anybody. Krishna really is, he's a personality is, if you want me, just me. Nobody else. Nobody else in the other realm of existence called Maya. So the qualification for success in spiritual life, or the qualification of an aspiring disciple, is they don't want to enjoy this world. When the spiritual master sees that within the person, then he pours his mercy into that person as much as they can accept that mercy. So that's one of the main qualifications. So, therefore, we should... No, just put the flower here. That's it. Thank you. So, therefore, Maya and Krishna are two opposites. You can't have both. So you might say, well, I still have material desires. That's fine. You can't stop having material desires just by not wanting them. But how do you function? The idea is, I don't act on them. I don't try to fulfill my material desires. I simply neglect them. And then that qualifies you to get the full mercy. As long as we are still looking towards material life for happiness and trying to fulfill our material desires, then it's very difficult, practically impossible, to approach Krishna consciousness. Like that. We remain on a very neophyte platform. A neophyte means one who doesn't make any advancement. Neophyte means one who likes to fight. not really, but anyway, it sounds good. The point is that this is one of the main qualifications of a sincere aspirant, is that they want Krishna. One should ask questions. One should be eager to understand things. And asking questions is part of that eagerness like that. The inquisitive disciple will, what we say, be in a good position to receive knowledge like that. Because the shastras and even the guru's words sometimes require some questions in order to get clarification. A lot of times Prabhupada would say something, and after he says it, it would leave people puzzled, because he speaks on a certain level making a certain point. But every spiritual principle has many sides to it, and so one can approach that principle from different angles, and each of the angles can be correct. So inquiry, inquisitive person, inquisitive student is tadvidi pratipatena pariprasyena. Patipat and paripras. Paripras means to inquire, patipat means to submit, right? Yeah. So one should inquire from the spiritual master. A question? Yeah.
Advaita Charan is asking from Champagne. Maharaj, in connection to your answer to Carlos Prabhu's question, there is the pastime of Lord Chaitanya glorifying the faith of Murari Gupta and Lord Ram. And he says, great is the master who doesn't leave his servant, and great is the servant who never leaves the shelter of his master.
Right.
So how do we understand this and the situation where one accepts someone else as a guru later on?
Someone is accepting someone else as a guru later on? You mean shiksha?
He doesn't clarify whether it's shiksha or diksha.
Your relationship with your spiritual master is your relationship with Krishna. It's eternal. The Mayavadis, their understanding is you need a guru until you get to the liberated platform, and then you kick the guru away. You don't need him. They use the example, a ladder will help you climb up to a house, and when you get to the top of the house, you don't need the ladder anymore. But that's not our philosophy. Our philosophy is that the spiritual master remains the eternal guide, and even when we go back home, back to Godhead, he's there to greet us. So, yeah. So you know, you can't give up your spiritual master. I answered one question saying that if you are inspired by someone else, you can take that person as your shiksha. But you don't give up your diksha guru. You can never do that. And your shiksha could be your prominent. But you're grateful to your diksha guru because he's the one that brought you out of the material existence. What's the question of giving up? No question. That's not a disciple anymore. That's like when people get married and they want to give up their husband or wife and get a new one. Can't do that with guru. If your spiritual master falls down, now, this is addressed by, very good question, thank you. This is addressed by Srila Narahari Sakar in his Bhajanamrita, where he says that if there's some question that your spiritual master has fallen, you should approach him in a lonely place and inquire about his situation. And if you get answers, then based on those answers, you can either continue or not continue. But if it's confirmed, well, spiritual master has fallen, then one may, you know, continue executing devotional service. One does not have to take reinitiation. Reinitiation is not mandatory. Although we allow reinitiation within our society because some people require that, but you're initiated because when you were initiated, your spiritual master was in good standing and therefore you're connected already. So you take shelter of the process of devotional service and Srila Prabhupada's books and associate with devotees and you can continue on, but that person no longer can guide you in spiritual life because they're fallen like that. We have many examples. unfortunately. Yes.
What happens if the spiritual master may accidentally fall down, but then like corrects the situation or comes back to his previous standard?
Depends on the severity of the accident. If it's a slight slip, then he can come back up again. But if it's a major slip, then he may have to stop his activities of a spiritual master for some time. I can think of many cases right now where, you know, after some time, depending on the severity of the slip, they can come back again. But sometimes it never happens, and sometimes it takes a long time, and sometimes it's quick, depending on, you know, the severity of the slip, and depending on their ability to rectify it, like that. But Prabhupada says, a real spiritual master, one who is actually a spiritual master, cannot fall down. That means he's on the platform where he's not going to fall. But he doesn't think like that. He always thinks that, and Prabhupada used the example that I'm always praying to my spiritual master that I don't fall into Maya. So what keeps you from falling down is humility. And if you're not humble, then Maya will look for opportunities to cause you to fall. Yes. Yes, okay. Microphone runner. Oh, no. She had a question. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't even see your hand. But you're next. Okay.
Sorry about that, Prabhu. My question, I don't know if it was answered while I was walking around, but what is considered a fall down for a spiritual master?
Breaking the principles, you know, illicit sex, intoxication, meat eating, gambling, like that. Going outside of the proper etiquette, like that. That's a slight fall down. Major fall down is breaking some major principles, like that.
Is a slight fall down reasons or grounds to leave your spiritual master, though?
Generally, no. Jai Sisi Kishore Kishore Ki Jai. There's such a bond between the spiritual master and the disciple that even a slight fall down doesn't. But because of that activity, they're no longer able to do that service. In other words, they can't make more disciples. They won't be allowed to make any more disciples. A slight fall down would be like he decides to take a trip to Bermuda and lay on the beach and watch all the scenery, you know, something like that. Still a fall down. Or he's watching, you know, cartoons or something, I don't know. You know, he's doing some frivolous activity that has nothing to do with spiritual life. You know, that's a slight fall down, but that's a fall down too. There's so many ways to fall down. So many. Prabhupada used to say, don't be surprised who stays. Don't be surprised who goes. Be surprised who stays. Question?
Hare Krishna Maharaj. This is actually for the previous session. So you said that real initiation is Brahmanical initiation?
complete.
Yeah, complete initiation. It's kind of confusing because what if one's nature is not Brahmanical? One's nature is Kshatriya-like or Vaishya-like or even Shudra-like. Like the scriptures say that one can be a Chandala, or one can be, let's not talk about Chandala, but one can be, we were recently reading that if one is born in a Chandala family, the Vedic culture is, he's treated as a Vaishnava, but as per social norms, they don't give him Brahmanical thread. Even if he's considered above Brahmanas,
yeah,
they don't perform the Upanayana for him, just because he started chanting Hare Krishna.
Yeah, but our process is not Vanarsham, it's Daivi Vanarsham. So if that person's chanting 16 rounds, following the principles, engaged in devotional service, and is exhibiting, you know, some of the qualities of a Brahmana, they can be considered given second initiation. But, you know, engaging according to, you know, one's Varna is part of the Daivi Vanarsham system. A person may be engaged in a certain way, but still, they can come up to the standard of, you know, having Vaishnav qualities. Because there's Vaishnav qualities which are transcendental to Brahminical qualities. Brahminical qualities are still within the category of the Vanarsham system. Vaishnav qualities are humility, surrender to the instructions of the spiritual master, complete faith in the instructions of the spiritual master, complete obedience in the instructions of the spiritual master. These are Vaishnav qualities. So a person may be engaged in different ways, just like a person may be working. I mean, this is a good question, because I know certain spiritual masters, at least I know one or two, that won't give Brahminical initiation to anybody who is working outside. Because it says a Brahmin doesn't work for anyone. A Brahmin has to live according to his own means. But then again, this is Western society. It says, you know, Brahmins will go to the marketplaces and pick up the grains left by, you know, the traders there and go to the fields. Even if he has to beg, he won't take employment from anyone. That's the nature of a real Brahmin. But we're not following that, you know, the Vanarsham system so much. We're trying to preach Krishna consciousness. So in trying to preach Krishna consciousness, we make some adjustments in the highest standard in order to act according to time, place, and circumstance. So if a person is sincerely engaging in devotional service, he may be given Brahminical initiation like that. So it depends on how strictly we want to follow that principle. You follow?
Follow-up question, if I might.
Yeah.
So in one letter, Prabhupada says, Prabhupada corrects a disciple who says something similar to saying Brahman initiation is a real initiation. He says that Prabhupada, I'm not able to recollect the exact words, so I'm paraphrasing, you can correct me. He says, everything you need to know is already in the first initiation. Just by chanting, you can perfect your life. It's not, Brahman initiation is not really needed.
That may be a letter, but there is a statement in the Shastras that one has to take second initiation, otherwise one has not completed the process of initiation. I didn't have time in between last class and this class to look up that, but I will for the next class. So, but I have that statement. It's there. And I recently found it, because that's always been people used to write to me, if you don't have second initiation, can you go back home, back to Godhead? So the question is, the idea is follow the process, and if there's some lack for some reason, then mercy can also overshadow the lack. Everything is not cut and dry. You can even go back to Godhead without initiation if you are that pure. If you're just chanting the holy names. I know one devotee who, I won't mention his name, he constantly chants the holy names. He's not initiated. So, but you might say, you know, you can see the symptoms of his spiritual life is that in a previous life, obviously he was connected to, you know, the process. Otherwise, he couldn't be doing what he's doing now. But we don't take that for granted because we don't know previous life. We have to follow, you know, what's happening in this life. So therefore, there has to be a standard in order for everyone to follow. But there's always exceptions. Every rule has an exception. Right? Every rule has an exception. But the exception is not the rule. That's the important part. So there are cases where you can go back to Godhead without second initiation, without first initiation. But that's an exception. Any other questions? Oh, okay, we're over time. I didn't realize that. So, qualification of a disciple. Whoa, I'm getting into it. All right, and then tomorrow we start with, let's talk about some real down-to-home, everyday, nitty-gritty events, like, you know, some basic stuff on, we get a little bit outside of the hard philosophical things, and we'll talk about some of the more subtle aspects of this relationship, like that. Okay. All right, so we quit. Anything else? Huh? Say again? Yeah, 3:30 is the next class, and it's more focusing on disciples, qualifications of a disciple. Are we going too slow? No? Because there's a lot of information, and I'm taking questions because I know it's important, but there's... Disqualifications of a disciple, we could talk about that. That's scheduled for tomorrow. But I noticed as we talk about all these different points, everything kind of overlaps. So we'll find there's another overlapping. But that's to be expected. So between now and 3:30, also think about some more of your questions that you want. Okay. Yes. Well, yeah, anyone who wants some of this information, she has there's a sheet there. You can sign your name and write your email, and I can send it on your email. Or if you'd like, you can give me a, you know, USB port, stick, flash drive, and I'll put it on there for you also. So either way. The email I'll probably do within a few days. The stick, I can do that within the next day or so. So, okay. Thank you. Bon appetit. Hare Krishna.